I was healed of fibromyalgia and environmental illness.
I was healed of Lyme disease.
I was healed of lupus and heart failure.
Because people like you partnered with Andrew Wommack Ministries, we've all been given our lives back. We cannot thank you enough for your generosity, but there are still millions more out there seeking the truth that set us free. Will you help us bring this message to them?
You can reach people like me who are trapped in their home and not aware of the fullness of what the gospel says, that we can be free from everything the enemy tried to put on us.
I would not be here if it wasn't for this ministry, and I just really encourage you to become a partner today.
Why wouldn't you want to partner with Andrew Wommack Ministries? Become a partner today.
To help us set more people free, become a partner by visiting awmi.net/give or call our helpline at 719-635-1111. We'd love to have you join us today.
Welcome to Gospel Truth with Andrew Wommack, a teaching ministry that focuses on God's unconditional love and grace.
We have a better covenant upon better promises, and we have a better relationship with God.
We were at such a desperate place that Andrew, it was like life. It was just life that was coming from the television. And every area in our life has been turned right side up.
And now, here's Andrew.
Welcome to our Tuesday's broadcast of the Gospel Truth. Today, I'm continuing to teach on hardness of heart. I've been on this now. This is my fourth week, and this coming Friday will be the last day that I speak on this on television. And so I encourage you to please go to the effort to get this teaching. I've got it in book form. This is a real small book. It's not a big one. It's only 90 pages, but it's powerful. And I've also got this teaching in hardness of heart on CD and DVD, and this coming Friday will be the last time that we advertise it. So please go to the effort to get this material. I tell you, this is a deal changer. I pray that you've listened to this. You know, if you've missed any of this, you can go to our website and you can go get the entire teaching. It's all archived there and you can listen to this. You can download it onto your devices, or you can get the book and these materials. But you need to get this teaching. And I know that there's people that you haven't heard the other things that I've been saying for the last 3 weeks. I haven't got time to put this into its proper context, but I tell you, it is important that you get this as a unit. I've said this a number of times, but this is something that is foundational in my life. I use this every day of my life to evaluate, am I putting God first? Am I seeking first the kingdom of God? Is my mind stayed upon Him? Because I realize that whatever I am focused upon, that's what's going to dominate me. And I want to be focused on God and have His kingdom rule and dominate in my life. And so anyway, the last couple of days, what I've been doing is talking about that 2 Corinthians chapter 10, verses 3 through 5. Talks about our weapons can take captive imaginations, cast them down, and take captive every single thought and bring it into captivity to and obedience to Christ. Most people don't even have that as a goal. They have their spiritual life and then their carnal life. There shouldn't be such a thing. We ought to be seeking God every minute of every day. And again, I know if you're one of those that's just tuned in today, you may sit there and say, that's impossible, it's impractical, and you may not even desire it because you got things in your life that you know aren't the way that God would do things, and yet you like it. Well, you aren't going to experience God's best when you departmentalize your life and just have a portion of your life that is given to God, but not the whole thing. You know, the scriptures that the Lord used to change my life are Romans chapter 12, verses 1 and 2. And it says, I beseech you therefore, brethren, by the mercies of God, that you present your bodies a living sacrifice, holy, acceptable unto God, which is your reasonable service. That's not just for the super saint, for the clergy. This is for every one of us. We should be a living sacrifice. And then verse 2 says, and don't be conformed to this world, but be ye transformed by the renewing of your mind, that you may prove what is that good and acceptable and perfect will of God. If you want to see God's perfect will come to pass in your life, then you have to transform yourself through the renewing of your mind. The battle is in the mind. Whatever your mind is focused upon, it becomes a self-fulfilling prophecy. As a man thinks in his heart, so is he. Proverbs 23:7. So the cure to a hardened heart, because your heart just goes in the direction of your dominant thought. The cure to a hardened heart is to change your thinking and put your thinking, your mind, your heart upon God 100%. And as you do that, your heart will turn and your heart will become sensitive to God. So that's the cure. But the big question is, how do you do that? Let me share this passage with you. Jesus is the one speaking in Matthew chapter 6. And in verse 19, he says, "Lay not up for yourselves treasures upon earth, where moth and rust doth corrupt, and where thieves break through and steal. But lay up for yourselves treasures in heaven, where neither moth nor rust doth corrupt, and where thieves do not break through nor steal." And then in verse 21, it says, "For where your treasure is, there will your heart be also." You know, that's interesting to me, because most people would think that where your heart is, that's where your treasure will be. But Jesus said it just the opposite. Where your treasure is, your heart will follow that. So the reason I'm bringing these passages up is to say, how do you get your heart to where it is stayed upon God and focused upon God? One of the ways to do that is with your finances. You give and your heart will follow what you give to. Now that may not, again, most people would disagree with that, but I'm quoting Jesus, and he said, "Where your treasure is, there will your heart be also." You know, if you were here with me physically in this television studio, and if you gave me your purse or you gave me your wallet and it had all of your money and your credit cards and everything valuable in it, and if I walked out of this place, you know what? Your heart would go with me. Your attention would go with me. You would be thinking, what's he going to do with my money? What's he going to do with these things? And in a sense, you can do that. You can actually direct your heart towards God by giving to the things of God, by putting your money into the things of God. You can invest and your money will go there. You know, if you go and buy a CD, I'm not talking about a compact disc, but a certificate of deposit. If you go buy a certificate of deposit and you give your money to that bank, did you know that when you go home, you're thinking about this and you're thinking, man, how is this going to grow? And you'll go home and you'll start taking the percentages and you'll anticipate and you think about it and that grabs your attention and you think about it. That's the way you need to do with offerings and stuff. You can literally give and direct your heart towards the things of God. That's a strong statement, but that's exactly what Jesus is saying. In the next verse, he says, "The light of the body is the eye. If therefore thine eye be single, thy whole body shall be full of light. But if thine eye be evil," notice he's using single and evil contrasting. So you could say it this way, that if you aren't single upon the things of God, then it's evil. And yet again, many people would say, no, you have this part of your life that is devoted to God, but then you have this other part over here that has nothing to do with God. You're just over here doing your own thing and stuff. Well, then that's evil, according to this. Anything that's not single, anything that isn't focused upon God is evil. The Apostle Paul said this in Philippians chapter 3. He says, "This one thing I do, forgetting those things that are behind, I press on towards the mark for the prize of the high calling of God in Christ Jesus." The Apostle Paul was successful because he did one thing. His whole life goal was to know God and to make Him known. And he laid his life on the line. He wasn't out to preserve himself. He wasn't out to become rich. He wasn't out to do anything except to know God and to make God known to other people. And because of it, he wrote half of the books in the New Testament. Here we are 2,000 years later talking about a man who traveled the known world of his day and made a huge impact because he did one thing. If you want to destroy a person's vision, give them two. If you want to diminish the success of a person, let them multitask. I know I get in trouble every time I say this. My wife even says that she can multitask, but I don't believe that that's a positive thing. Paul said, this one thing I do. When you multitask, it just means you do multiple things less than what you could if you were to focus on one and do that thing at one time. Maybe I'm just a simple person, but I can't effectively multitask. Man, I just get focused. You know, we have a ministry and I have to get into some administrative things and things like that, but I can't just deal with finances and make all of these decisions and then walk in and just start teaching. I can do it to a degree, but it's not good. I do much better if I just dedicate one day that this is my day, that I'm focused on these things. And I have to nearly get into another zone to be able to deal with all the administrative things that I have to deal with. You need to get to where you just do one thing. And I don't do this perfectly, but I've hired a lot of people to take care of all of my administrative things. I do as little as I possibly can. I stay focused on what God called me to do. And so this is saying that you can literally direct your heart in a way by being single-minded. And instead of working a job so that you can get a nice house, a nice car, all the clothes that you want, the jewelry, the movies, the entertainment, the food and stuff, and then you give to God as an afterthought. You ought to work so that you can be a blessing. And your focus is on the giving, but you also use a portion of the money that comes in to take care of your needs. I know some of you think, man, that you can't live that way. Let me show you a passage of Scripture where the Apostle Paul said this exact same thing. In Ephesians chapter 4, and in verse 28, it says, "Let him that stole steal no more, but rather let him labor, working with his hands, the thing that is good, that he may have a nice house and a nice car and nice everything." Nope, that's not what it says. The reason you do this, labor, working with your hands, the thing which is good, that you may have to give to him that needeth. The Scripture actually teaches, matter of fact, back in Matthew chapter 6, I'm going to get to this, maybe not finish it today, but sometime this week, it'll say right here, "Seek first the kingdom of God and His righteousness, and all of these things will be added unto you." The things He's talking about is where you sleep, what you're clothed with, what you eat. These physical, natural things should be a byproduct. It should be secondary. The focus ought to be God. The focus ought to be putting first the kingdom of God in your thoughts, in your actions, in your finances. We ought to be giving ourselves 100% to God. And if we do that, all of these natural things would come as a byproduct. Most people sit there and are watching this and thinking, that is absolutely absurd. You can't live that way. If I didn't give priority to paying my rent or my house payment and my car payment and food and all of these things, and if I didn't do that, and if I just put God first, I'd have nothing. That's true unless there's a God who said in Luke chapter 6, verse 38, that give and it shall be given unto you, good measure, pressed down, shaken together, and running over shall man give into your bosom. But since there is a God who promised that when you give, He's going to give it back to you supernaturally, then the way to prosper, the way to increase in the kingdom of God is not to hoard and keep everything you got, but to give. Open up your hands and let it flow through. It's counter to the natural way of thinking. But that's exactly what all of these verses are saying. The reason you work is so that you can have to give to him that needs, not so that you can have more stuff. If your goal was, God, I want to be a bigger blessing. I want to give more. I want to be a bigger blessing. If that was your goal, God would bless you supernaturally. If he can get it through you, he will get it to you. You know, I'm not a perfect example. I've never tried to present myself that way. But man, this is the way I try and live. I don't do it perfectly. I hadn't arrived, but I've lived. And my wife and I, we give and give and give. This last year, we gave away like 120 or 130% of our yearly income. Now, we can't do that every year, but I mean, we give a lot. And some years, we give more than what we take in. And because of it, God just blesses us. I tell you what, we are blessed. We can't turn around without being blessed. And because, see, that is our goal. We're doing what Ephesians 4:28 says. We live to give. And God knows that the givers also have to eat, and you also need a place to sleep. And so God just takes care of us as a byproduct. But my goal isn't taking care of me. My goal is taking care of other people, being a blessing to other people. And as God enables me to do that, He also takes care of me. And God is El Shaddai, not El Cheapo. He is not a tightwad. He will take care of you better than you'll take care of yourself. You know, I live in a house that back, my wife and I built it in 1988. And we were very poor back then. I couldn't have even built the house if I didn't have a Veteran Association loan. And I got a no down payment and low interest VA loan. And we built as much house as we possibly could, but it was only probably a 2,200 square foot house. And it only cost me $60,000. That's the house that I live in. Now we've added to it. The property was probably $40,000. We've got 26 acres that it sits on. And so we've added to it. And I'm not saying it's a bad place. I love it, but it's just not huge. But it was probably a $120,000 house when it was built, but I got it built for $60,000 because we were putting the kingdom of God first, seeking first the kingdom of God. And I had a builder come to me and basically give me this house for half the price. And we got the thing paid off, I think, in 10 years. And we've been debt-free for 20 years or whatever. And God just blessed us. But I say all of these things about how do you keep your mind and your heart stayed upon the Lord? These verses are saying that you put first the kingdom of God. Where your treasure is, there will your heart be also. You need to start giving. And as you give and put blessing other people ahead of blessing yourself, did you know it will direct your heart towards the things of the Lord? And again, there's no reason to do this unless you believe what the Word of God says, unless you believe there's something happening in the unseen realm that you can't see. Why would you take a portion of what you've got and just give it away? That doesn't make sense to the natural mind. For you to do that, you are forcing yourself to look beyond the physical. If you remember my teaching last week about anablepo, to see twice, you aren't just seeing what's directly in front of your face, but you're seeing beyond that to God as being the source. Not just your job, but God is the one who blesses you and gives you the power to get wealth. And you're doing all of that. See, when you start giving, you are moving beyond just the natural, and it will move your heart towards God. It'll help make you sensitive to God. Man, I could get off and spend a few weeks just teaching on finances right here, but let me just say some things quickly that I have never met a person that I consider to be a mature Christian, which that is somewhat subjective, and different people might have a different evaluation of what a mature Christian is. But in my estimation, a mature Christian is a person who's going to be able to handle the blows that life gives against you. You aren't going to just serve God when the sun's shining and everything's good. But if things go bad, you're still going to be serving God. You're committed to God, whether you see it work for your advantage or not. I consider that a mature Christian. And I have never met a mature Christian who wasn't a committed, faithful giver. Never. But I have met bunches of Christians who loved God, and at the moment everything was just fine. But I don't have any confidence that if, you know, they get a bad diagnosis, or if their mate leaves them, or if they lose their job or something, that they are going to still be serving God. They may just chuck it and run the other direction. I've met lots of Christians like that, and without exception, those people are not faithful, committed givers. So the point I'm making is there is a direct relationship between maturity and the way you handle money. Or you could say it in the light of what we're teaching, there is a direct relationship between a person having a sensitive heart towards God and their giving. People who do not give and not trust God in this area of finances are not people with soft hearts towards God. They've got a hardened heart in that area. That's what these verses are talking about. It goes on to say in verse 24, no man can serve two masters, for either he will hate the one and love the other, or else he will hold to the one and despise the other. You cannot serve God and mammon. Mammon right here is an old English word for money, but it literally is referring to the demonic spirit that often uses money, that is behind money. And you can't serve God and be at the same time committed to money. You can't put your trust in money. You have to put your trust in God. And there's a lot of people watching this program and say, oh, well, I trust God. I can look at your giving and tell whether you really trust God. And you could say, oh, no, I trust God, but I'm just right now in a situation where I need all the money that I can get. And, well, you can say what you want to, but if you aren't giving, you do not trust God. If you trust God, there's promises that no man, Mark chapter 10, there is no man that hath left house, father, mother, brother, sister, lands for my sake and the gospel's, but what he will receive 100-fold in this life with persecution and in the world to come, everlasting life. God has promised you 100-fold return on your giving in this life and then in the world to come, eternal life. So it has benefits that are out of this world, but you get 100-fold return in this life. If you really believe that, if you really trusted that, I don't care what situation you find yourself in, you would be giving. And if you aren't giving, you can whitewash it any way you want to, but the truth is you trust that money and what that money can do for you more than you trust what God can do for you. That's tight, but it's right. That's what these verses are saying. You can't serve God and mammon. You can't put your trust in God and put your trust in money at the same time. You have to trust God, and it will be reflected in your giving. And then he goes on to say, man, I'm running short of time. I'm not going to be able to cover all of this today. That's the reason you need to get this material. But he goes on to say, therefore I say unto you, take no thought for your life, what ye shall eat or what ye shall drink, nor yet for your body what ye shall put on. Is not life more than meat, and the body than raiment? Behold the fowls of the air, for they sow not, neither do they reap, nor gather into barns, yet your heavenly Father feedeth them. Are ye not much better than they? I have to explain that for some people today, because there's some people that worship the creature more than they worship the Creator. There are people that are sitting there just, well, I'm gonna avoid going there, but there are some people that totally have misplaced priorities, and they are compassionate towards all of these animals, which I'm not an animal hater. I love animals, but I glorify God more than that. This is saying that God loves you more than He loves the birds of the air. God loves men more than He loves the animal creation. We were created in His likeness. There is no comparison. Again, this doesn't mean that that's an excuse for you to treat animals bad, but boy, there's people that have their priorities totally out of line there. It says, which of you by taking thought can add one cubit unto his stature? And why take ye thought for raiment? Consider the lilies of the field, how they grow. They toil not, neither do they spin. And yet I say unto you that even Solomon in all of his glory was not arrayed like one of these. Wherefore, if God so clothe the grass of the field, which today is and tomorrow is cast into the oven, shall He not much more clothe you, O ye of little faith? Man, that's awesome. And this next verse, I've got something really powerful I want to say here, but I hadn't got time to say it today. I'll have to deal with this tomorrow. Again, I would like to encourage you to please get this teaching on hardness of heart. This is something that is foundational in my life. I promise you this would explain some things to you and give you a goal to shoot at of keeping your mind stayed upon the Lord. It would help you tremendously. It's one of the most important things that God has shown me. So I've got it in book form. I've also got it in CDs and in DVDs. And remember that this coming Friday is going to be my last day to offer these products over our television program. So if you're going to respond, you need to respond today or this week. Listen to our announcer as he gives you information about how you can receive all of this product. Please call or write today to get the product, and then join me again tomorrow as we continue our teaching on hardness of heart.
Andrew's complete series titled Hardness of Heart is available in either a CD or DVD album and a book in either English or Spanish. Each of these valuable resources is available for a gift of any amount when you write or call. You can get these products as part of the Hardness of Heart package, but you can receive all of these valuable resources for just $55. Andrew's book, Hardness of Heart, is also available for a gift of any amount when you write or call. We encourage everyone to give because there's a blessing in giving. But if you're simply unable to afford it, Andrew and his partners will provide this book to you free of charge.
On today's program, I talked a lot about giving, and of course, you don't have to give to this ministry. There's many ways that you can give to your church, to people, all kinds of things. But you know, many of you are being fed through this ministry. God is speaking to you, and I would encourage you that you need to sow. Where your treasure is, there will your heart be also. And I encourage you to give, to become a part of what we're doing. We reach people all over the world. We have over 3.2 billion people who could receive this program on a daily basis. And I tell you, when you give into this ministry, you are touching people all over the world. So listen to our announcer, become a part of what we're doing by becoming a partner with us today.
We want to say a special thank you to the Grace Partners of Andrew Wommack Ministries. Your gifts make it possible to put free ministry materials into the hands of many people in need. If you're not already a Grace Partner, we ask you to pray about becoming one today. You can become a Grace Partner or order resources through our website at awmi.net or call our helpline Monday through Friday from 4:30 a.m. to 9:30 p.m. Mountain Time at 719-635-1111. To write us, use the address on your screen.
Welcome to the AWM Minute, a small glimpse on how your partnership with Andrew Wommack Ministries and Caris Bible College has allowed us for decades to sow the word for free into countless lives.
Everything that God has for you, healing, deliverance, prosperity, anything that you need is in this word.
To celebrate all God has done through your partnership, Andrew has produced his latest video, A Ministry of Sowing, where you will see how your support is producing a harvest in countless lives through television, prayer, free materials, events, Caris Bible College, and more. Everything we are seeing today is a result of what you, our partners, have sown into Andrew Wommack Ministries. To view this expression of our gratitude, go to awmi.net today